So welcome to this lecture series on environment and ecology presented by Mentors for IAS in association with Bangalore IAS Academy and Nama KPSC. Now this particular session here is an initiative of Nama KPSC to help students to prepare and study from home with the help of YouTube videos, current affairs available on the website, PDF materials for every subject, and online tests to track your preparation. So do remember to visit www.namakpsc.com for more information. Now in this particular video, we will be discussing about climate forcings and the global warming potential of some of the greenhouse gases that we have discussed in the previous video. Now first, we will begin our discussion with climate forcings. So first of all, what is this climate forcings? Now climate forcings are nothing but your factors, are nothing but the factors in the climate system. These are nothing but the factors in the climate system that either increase or decrease the effects to the climate system. This is nothing but the factors in the climate system that either increase, that will either increase or decrease the effects to the climate system. So here you have positive climate forcings. We have positive climate forcings and also negative climate forcings. Positive forcings are such as excess greenhouse gases that warm the earth, whereas negative forcings are such effects that say for example aerosols or volcanic eruptions that will result in cooling of the earth. So when there is increase in the temperature or there is warming of the earth's atmosphere, then we say it is positive forcings. When there is a cooling effect which is introduced, then we say it is negative climate forcings. So now if you take atmospheric aerosols, which include volcanic dust, soot from the combustion of fossil fuels, particles from burning forests, mineral dusts, all these, what will they do? They will actually, it is possible that these aerosols are to some extent, including your dark carbon rich particles such as from soot from your diesel engines, they will absorb the sunlight and they will warm the atmosphere. So if they are warming the atmosphere, it is what? It is nothing but positive forcings. Conversely, exhaust from high sulfur coal or oil produce light aerosols that reflect sunlight back to space, producing a cooling effect. If it is a cooling effect, it is nothing but negative forcings. So these aerosols that form naturally during volcanic eruptions cool the atmosphere. Large volcanic eruptions can eject enough ash into the atmosphere to lower temperature for a year or more until the sulfate particles settle out of the atmosphere on the ground. This is possible. And over the course through history, throughout history, there have been many super volcanoes which have spewed out so much of ash that it blocks the sunlight so that we are not able to receive sunlight on the surface, and it has changed in the warming or cooling pattern itself. So when I say change, it generally results in cooling down of the earth as it blocks or as it cuts down the sunlight that is able to be received on the ground. So discussing about climate forcings, here we will discuss about the altering of the energy balance, natural forcings, human induced forcings, human generated greenhouse gases with respect to climate forcings, human generated aerosols with respect to climate forcings, and the way climate change is caused due to this climate forcing, which is obvious as of now because it causes cooling or increase in warming depending on if it is negative or positive forcings. So now if you consider altering the energy balance, altering the energy balance. See, the power of a process to alter the climate is estimated by its radiative forcing. It is estimated by its radiative forcing. So, the power of a process to alter the climate is estimated by its radiative forcing, that is the change in the Earth's energy balance due to that process. So, as I've mentioned earlier, some climate forcings are positive, causing globally averaged warming, and some are negative, causing cooling of the Earth. So, some such as the increase in carbon dioxide concentrations are well known, others such as in the form of aerosols are much to be known about. Then, natural forcings. Natural forcings include changes in the amount of energy emitted by the sun, very slow variations in the Earth's orbit, and volcanic eruptions. Since the start of the Industrial Revolution, the only natural forcing with any long-term significance has been a small increase in solar energy reaching the Earth. However, this change is not nearly enough to account for the current warming. So, natural forcings are actually very, very slow and very less when compared to human-induced forcings. So, next we move on to human-induced forcings itself. Now, coming to human-induced forcing or climate forcing can also be caused by human activities. So, this is obvious. These activities include what? Nothing but the emission of greenhouse gases and aerosol emissions from burning fossil fuels and modifications of the land surface such as deforestation, which has the ability to remove greenhouse gases from the atmosphere, where these greenhouse gases also result in a positive impact, that is increase in warming of the Earth. So next, coming to human generated greenhouse gases itself. Greenhouse gases obviously are a positive climate forcing, that is they have a warming effect. Carbon dioxide emitted from the burning of fossil fuel is presently the largest single climate forcing agent, accounting for more than half of the total positive forcing since 1750s, since your Industrial Revolution. Next, human generated aerosols. Now, burning fossil fuels also adds aerosols to the atmosphere. Aerosols are nothing but your tiny particles in the atmosphere composed of many things, including water, ice, ash, mineral dust, or acidic droplets. Aerosols can deflect the sun's energy and impact the formation and lifetime of clouds. Aerosols are a negative forcing, that is, they have a cooling effect, as I have mentioned earlier. Then coming to climate change itself, while natural forcings do exist, they are not significant enough to explain the recent global warming. So, human activities are very much or very likely responsible for most of the recent warming. So, we could say that these climate forcings which are causing the global climate change is due to human activities, and these human activities through climate forcings are causing climate change that we refer to as global warming, that we refer to as global warming. So, with this, I hope you have some idea about climate forcing. So, for example, in a question in your civil services examination or your state public service examination, you could have a question where some of the gases or some of the constants are given, and then you have to identify if it is going to result in positive forcing or negative forcing. Please remember, positive forcing results in warming or increasing the temperature of the Earth. Negative forcing results in cooling or reduction in the temperature of the Earth. Now, we will begin our discussion about something known as global warming potential. Now, since we have already discussed about global warming and also greenhouse gases which cause global warming, now it is apt that we discuss about global warming potential. Now, before we move on, before we start a discussion about the global warming potential itself, first it is important for us to understand as to how do we estimate, how do we estimate the effect of each greenhouse gas? How do we estimate the effect of each greenhouse gas? Now, each of the greenhouse gases' effect on climate change actually depends on three main factors. So first, we have to ask how much of these gases, are present in the atmosphere, See, concentration or abundance is nothing but the amount of a particular gas in the air. So the greenhouse gas concentrations are actually measured in parts per million, parts per billion, or even parts per trillion. So just to make it simpler, one part per million is nothing but equivalent to one drop of water diluted into about 13 gallons of that liquid. So here it is important for us to determine what is the concentration of a particular greenhouse gas present in the atmosphere. The concentration of the greenhouse gas will affect the potential of that greenhouse gas to cause global warming. So the first important thing that we always have to determine before talking about the global warming potential of a greenhouse gas is what? Its concentration or the abundance of this particular greenhouse gas in the atmosphere. Second, how long will the greenhouse gas, remain or stay in the atmosphere? Now see, each of the greenhouse gases can remain in the atmosphere for different amounts of time, ranging from a few years to even hundreds of years. All of these greenhouse gases remain in the atmosphere long enough to become well mixed, meaning that the amount that is measured in the atmosphere is roughly the same all over the world, regardless of the source of the emissions. So the duration up to which the greenhouse gases remain or present or are present in the atmosphere will also affect its global warming potential. See, in the previous video, while discussing about the greenhouse gases itself, I told you that black carbon does not remain in the atmosphere for a very long time. Therefore, its global warming potential comes down. Similarly, if you take carbon dioxide can remain in the atmosphere for a very, very long time, which actually increases its global warming potential. So its longevity in the atmosphere also plays a role in determining the global warming potential. Third, we have to determine how strongly will the greenhouse gas impact global temperatures. How strongly will this greenhouse gas impact global temperatures? So here it is important for us to determine that some gases are more effective than others at making the planet warmer or at trapping the heat which is re-emitted from the earth. So for each greenhouse gases, a global warming potential will be calculated depending on how much energy it is able to absorb, how much energy it is able to prevent from being re-emitted back into the space. This is one of the other criteria. So if you've understood these things, let us now move on to the global warming potential itself. So here on the right hand side, you have this table where I've mentioned some of the greenhouse gases, their global warming potential, and the lifetime of these gases in the atmosphere. So coming to global warming potential describes the impact of each gas on global warming. The global warming potential describes the impact of the greenhouse gas on global warming. The two most important characteristics of a greenhouse gas in terms of climate impact are how well the gas absorbs the energy and how long the gas stays in the atmosphere. The global warming potential for a gas is a measure of the total energy that a gas absorbs over a particular period of time compared to carbon dioxide. So gases with a higher carbon dioxide, gases with a higher global warming potential absorb more energy per pound than gases with a lower global warming potential and thus contribute to more warming of the earth. So here, as I've mentioned, this table which is given over here is important. Please do go through the table. So let us just briefly discuss about some of the global warming potential of the greenhouse gases. Take carbon dioxide first. Now, carbon dioxide has a global warming potential of 1 and serves as a baseline, and it serves as a baseline for other global warming potential values. So we will discuss or we will consider the global warming potential of other greenhouse gases by comparing it with carbon dioxide. So obviously it means that larger the global warming potential, more warming the gas causes. Take methane for example over here. Okay, now methane's global warming potential, a 100-year global warming potential is about 21, meaning that methane will cause 21 times as much warming as an equivalent mass of carbon dioxide over a 100-year time period. Methane has a global warming potential that is 21, meaning it is 21 times higher than that of carbon dioxide for a 100-year time scale. Methane which is emitted today will last, however, methane which is emitted today will last only for 12 years in the atmosphere on an average. But for a pound to pound basis, methane absorbs more energy than carbon dioxide, making its global warming potential higher. Now, if you take nitrous oxide has a global warming potential of about 300 times that of carbon dioxide for a 100-year time scale. Dinitrogen oxide emitted today remains in the atmosphere for an average of 120 years. If you take CFCs, hydrofluorocarbons, perfluorocarbons or sulfur hexachloride, they have very high global warming potential, and these are high global warming potential gases for a given amount of mass as they trap substantially more heat than carbon dioxide. So with this, I hope you have had some understanding as to what does it mean when it comes to global warming potential, because as you can see here, questions have been asked about global warming potential of greenhouse gases. So here the question says, which of the following gases have the highest global warming potential? So based on the previous slide, if you look at this particular table over here, you should be able to answer this particular question. So obviously the carbon dioxide potential is much less, whereas if you consider sulfur hexachloride, it has a global warming potential of around 23,900, which is 23,900 times more than that of carbon dioxide. Therefore, the correct answer is D, sulfur hexachloride. Similarly, another question was asked over here. Which of the following statements are correct regarding global warming potential of a greenhouse gases? So statement 1 says it compares the amount of heat trapped by a certain mass of the gas in question to the amount of heat trapped by a similar mass of carbon dioxide. Of course, I did mention the very same thing when I explained methane, saying that we will compare it with respect to the amount of heat which is trapped by carbon dioxide. So methane is able to trap more heat, meaning one molecule of methane should be able to trap the amount of heat which is trapped by 21 molecules of carbon dioxide. So obviously first statement is correct. Statement 2 says global warming potential of carbon dioxide has been fixed as 1. Of course, yes, straightforward. The third statement says a high global warming potential correlates with a large infrared absorption and a long atmospheric lifetime. Generally, yes, global warming potential will depend upon the ability to absorb energy and also its lifetime. So if either of them are more, obviously global warming potential will be more. Therefore, all the three statements are correct, and hence the correct answer is D, all of the above. So with this particular video, I hope you've understood something about climate forcings and global warming potential. If you do have any doubts, please do write to us in the comment section. Thank you for watching. Please do subscribe for more such videos. Thank you.